Alright, well, let's see. It's January 11th. That's 2015. We're in Bakersville, North Carolina. Came up for the afternoon, had some pizza, hung out, and I gave you the gist of what I'd like to talk about, but one thing I'd like to kick into our talk session first, though, is if you don't mind going across what we were talking about in the living room about your current issue, unless you don't want that to be on. Yeah, you know, you go to the doctor since for a long time, you know, for all the stuff that has to do with the military and, you know, gifts that Vietnam gave you that are still giving. And, anyway, go ahead and explain what that's all about, something about the pancreas and something they found or whatever.
Start?
Yeah, work out.
Okay, and basically in my lifetime, going all the way back to when I was a kid, I've been very, very fortunate in that I'm not a very religious individual, but I do feel that somehow or the other, somebody up there must like me. Because I've had so many close calls or situations where I really should not have survived it. And I have survived it so far, and right now I'm in the process of, I think, surviving another one. And that is, I've been a steady outpatient with the Veterans Administration and with the medical personnel from the services for a good many years. During a physical exam whereby they were chasing some other bugs that I might have, one more thing was added to my itinerary of possibly a tough or conflict coming up. I've had so far, both my knees have been totally replaced. I've had corrective surgeries on both elbows, on the right shoulder, had the bottom of the left lung removed, the right ankle has been corrected. That's a good start. I've also got Parkinson's, which is a presumptive of Agent Orange. I've got diabetes, which is a presumptive of Agent Orange. I've got ischemic heart failure, which is a presumptive of Agent Orange. And several other things I can't remember right off the top of my head.
Now you got something they saw.
Yeah, they saw just recently a spot on my lung and examined it. It hasn't changed any, so they're kind of sidestepping that one for a while. My thyroid went bad, so I had a operation on the right thyroid, and they took a piece of it. I turned out to be lucky in that another time, and that turned out to be nothing except that I've got a mark on my thyroid,
or
something that they're keeping an eye on. The latest thing though is that yesterday, or day before yesterday, I was notified by the VA that they're sending me to a specialized area in a different hospital where they can chase a spot that was discovered on my pancreas, which has changed in form and it's now more opaque than it was before. And so I'm being sent to a hospital that specializes in oncology to see just what that amounts to. I'm not really very worried about it. As I really wasn't very worried about the others. I also had my gallbladder removed. And my goodness, there's more there, but four hernia operations all gained from straining during technique in judo, mainly Ogoshi, Shiranagi, Ippon Shiranagi, and Taiyotoshi. Each one of those, I was a lot more, I was not quite as powerful as I thought I was when I came into them.
Yeah. I wanted to, something popped into my head that I thought would be semi-joke, because there's a story about mom and so how some of this stuff got aggravated.
Bike?
Yeah, the bike accident. And if you can go to the, what happened, and it'd be really cool to hear the role of the police officer. And then I can tell them from first-hand experience what happened with mom when you guys got home. But go ahead and explain that whole motorcycle accident, what happened, where you were and so on.
Well, I was captain in the Marine Corps at the time. I had come back from Vietnam. I was, at that time it wasn't popular, but now it is. I was suffering from advanced PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. I didn't know it. The feeling of ill at ease, tendency to drink too much, the changing of jobs a whole lot, although I really excelled at each job I did. All of that was attributed to the symptoms of the post-traumatic stress disorder. When I came back from Vietnam, I picked up First Lieutenant as the Executive Officer of the First Civil Affairs Group at Camp Pendleton. I was then promoted a year later to Captain. And better than a year later than that, I was on the list for major. However, I had to have a physical taken before I could accept that. And so I climbed on my trusty motorcycle and headed from Fort Ord at the language school to Oakmont Naval Hospital in Oakland, California, on my bike. Got to go over a mountain to get there. Well, I like to ride without the helmet. Got into the mountains, and as I dropped down out of the mountains, my ears got cold, so I reached back on a sissy bar and stuffed my helmet on my head. And about 10 minutes later, I was into the full traffic at San Jose. If you've ever been in California traffic, you can understand just how dangerous a situation that can be. We had bumper-to-bumper traffic running at 70 to 75 miles an hour. with all lanes full. I was in the left-hand passing lane, which nobody was passing. And just drifting along, enjoying the day, when suddenly the cars up ahead of me started piling up. And the guy behind me, I still remember it, in a yellow station wagon.
I'll bet.
He locked up. When he locked up, it was obvious he was going to hit me in the back end. So I peeled the bike over to the left and went into the retaining wall at about 70 miles an hour. Now, one of the things that really sticks out in my mind, and people think it's a big joke, but it really wasn't to me at the time. As I peeled over to the left, I saw I was going to hit the retaining wall, and I figured best thing for me to do is jump. Dumb thing to do, I should have rode the bike. But anyway, I jumped. As I jumped, I looked down, the speedometer said 70 miles an hour. And I remember it going through my mind real quick. I can't run this fast.
Right.
And I couldn't. I hit that wall rather smartly, breaking the helmet, breaking my head, breaking the shoulder, breaking 5 ribs on the left side, contusing the heart, collapsing both lungs, and rendering myself into a very solid, unconscious slumber. By the time I started to come to, and there were cars all over the damn street, and I was laid up against the retaining wall with a highway patrolman standing over me, other highway patrols, lots of lights and stuff all around me, and I couldn't breathe. The highway patrolman was an unusual individual in that he must have spent some time in country, because he, without thinking, did exactly what he should do. He reached over, took a ballpoint pen out of his pocket, cut the ends of it off, stuck the knife in me right up here into the trachea area, stuck the pen in there and blew, and it removed the pressure on the one lung so that it was able to inflate. Mm-hmm. Once I had that one lung inflated, I thought I was drowning up to that point. You know, suddenly I could gather short breaths. And he looked down, and I was in uniform. He looked down at my uniform, and he saw the campaign ribbons, and he said, "Captain, I see you've been to Vietnam." And I went, "Yeah." He said, "Did you get hit over there?" I said, "No." He said, "Well then, bud, you better hang on, because if you're bum kicked, go out on a California highway." And I agreed with him. Waited a little while, passed by a couple more times, and then suddenly I was in an ambulance to a civilian hospital, from there to Oklahoma Naval Hospital, made it to Oklahoma in record time, a lot faster than I had anticipated, with the traffic being the way it was. And I was put on the endangered list. I was in critical condition, and then in serious condition. And the Marine Corps contacted my wife, who was still down at Fort Ord, and they flew her up to Oaknall. Got babysitters for the kids. Flew her up to Oaknall, and next thing I know, she was standing by the bed. My mother had been informed, and she had also come up to Oaknall. My mother is like a Jewish mother. Then no ethnic or religious.
I think the folks will know what you mean.
But sure, she was very worried about her son. And she came in there throwing a regular Jewish mother type of hysteria. She said, son, tell me you'll never ride that motorcycle again. Please tell me you'll never ride a motorcycle again. And she went on and on about how I should swear I'd never ride a motorcycle again. I didn't know at that point if I'd ride anything again. But my wife, Pat, was standing by the bed. She listened to my mom for a while, and she finally said, Ernie, you going to be okay? And I got out. Yeah. She said, okay, I'll get the bike fixed. I let my mother down, and the rest of the visit was quite pleasant.
Yeah. Well, I remember, there's two things I remember. One was one of my favorite character statements about Mom was, one, when that call came through, I remember it well. There's Mom and the kitchen counter. She seemed upset. She was on the phone. The phone was on the wall. I remember the calendar and everything just like that. There's the window, the sink, and the counter. And I walked up, and that's frozen in my mind because I remember it was a real important thing. Because you had left, when you left for Vietnam, I remember the scene of we were on the tarmac and you got on the plane and stuff. So each time there's been some big thing, it gets frozen in my mind. But there's Mom, and she's getting upset getting the call, but she's not getting, it's like she refused to break down crying. But she was very businesslike, and we got the babysitters, and I knew something was really wrong because we didn't know the babysitter. Somebody had gotten, and then we had different ones along the way. And then the other moment I remember real well was I was riding my bicycle out in the parking lot area in front of our, because they look like, the base housing looked like apartments. Now, you'd been in the hospital one hell of a long time, and you know, I didn't know you were coming home that day. No one had said anything. All I knew, I saw Mom pull up in a car. And your motorcycle was sitting out front of the place. And I remember that. And I only remember this. They stopped the car, and Mom gets out of the car. And I stayed on my bicycle, and I didn't get off, and I didn't run up, because I could tell she seemed real serious. Mom would get a certain way. You didn't just run up and, hug. We weren't that kind of family anyway. She gets out of the car, she walks around, and she helps you get out, and she gets you them, the walking sticks you had, the kind that grab your forearm, like this, and she gets you standing up, and I think, we'll walk in the house. Uh-uh. He trots his way over there, and while he's trotting over there, she shuts the door, gets the car right, and walks ahead of him to the motorcycle. He gets up to the motorcycle, takes off those things, and it was quite the effort. He gets on the motorcycle, and I can't remember how, but they got the motorcycle started, and Dad went around the block and came back. And Mom helped him stop, helped him get off the motorcycle real slow, got those things back on your arms again, so you could walk, and helped you walk in the house. And the entire time, not one word was said.
Well, Mom believed that if you fall off the horse, get back on it, or you'll never ride it again.
Right, and that was explained. That was explained later. I thought that was, but the one thing I like, the difference between, a lot of advances in medicine have occurred, but the one advance that has actually stepped back, I think that they could probably bring back that would help us. You needed motivation in the hospital, and I've heard this story so many times. It was one of Mom's favorites when she was alive, about how they got you to walk down the hall to exercise.
Oh, yeah, it was up at Oak Knoll when I was bedridden.
Yeah.
Yeah, they... I hadn't gotten out of bed yet. I was having a hard time breathing, a hard time moving, just a hard time. And the guys, the medical staff at Oak Knoll was outstanding. Oak Knoll is the amputee center for the Marine Corps. We had wards that were full of guys who had lost their legs, had lost their arms, lost eyes or whatever it might be. And I remember my first experience on the quote sense of humor they had up there. One, you were not able to have a visitor or see anyone from the outside until you could walk to the elevator and back under your own power. Two, the guys screwed with each other continuously. I heard this yelling from this communal bathroom that we had between my room and another room. I walked in there and there was a fellow that had gotten hit and burned horribly on the one side of his face, and he lost an eye. And they had replaced the eye with a glass one. And he was yelling for the corpsman and yelling, what a lousy, unthoughtful, what a bitter thing for anyone to do. Well, while he was asleep, the corpsman had snuck into his room and turned his eye around. So when he looked in the mirror, here was his eye and this blank white thing looking back at him. That drew a laugh for most everybody. Went out in the hallway and there's black marks all up and down the hallway. That came from the guys in wheelchairs, drag racing. One of the guys that had lost an eye had his eye replaced, and he had been a drill instructor down in San Diego before he went into the country, into Vietnam. He lost his eye, and when they finally let him out of the hospital so he could move around, he went down to San Francisco to a jeweler and had that eye have a real tiny gold eagle, globe, and anchor symbol put on the inside of the eye so that you could see it from the outside. And it was actually inside, so you could see there was a lens over it and all. And his next duty station was going to be as a drill instructor at San Diego. And it just hit me so hard. I could just see some poor damn recruit standing there at attention while this drill instructor gets in his face and starts yelling about the glory of the globe and eagle, globe, and anchor, and he sees that gold one in that drill instructor's eye.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to the bedroom and stuff. I haven't been able to get out of bed yet. And my doctor came in and he said, "Captain, I understand from your wife and from some of your friends that you really enjoy having a beer." I said, "Yes, I really do." He said, "Well, I put the order in down at the nurse's desk," which was way, way down at the other end of the hall. And he said, "You can have two of them a day as soon as you can walk down there and get them." Yeah, I wasn't moving fast, but I got my two beers.
Mom used to say, she was there for one of the beers. She says, "Oh yeah, he was getting it. He was walking his way down." She laughed about that. She thought it was hilarious. But that's how they got him motivated. Yeah.
Well, cut the long, very long story short here. I started healing up pretty good, and they released me after a few months, and I went back down to Fort Ord to the language school. Checked out there because they said I wasn't going back to Vietnam right away. And then went before a board, and they put me on a quote temporary disability retired list, which meant until I was cured or improved, I would not be able to go back on duty. I was on the retired list, which meant I could do anything I wanted to, but I was no longer in the Marine Corps. except as a temporary retiree. Didn't know where to go, what to do. But I knew a Dr. Brister from Michigan State University that I had worked with in developing a physical fitness program for the Marine Corps a couple of years prior to this. And Dr. Brister was the athletic director for Michigan State. I contacted him, told him the situation I was in, and then I could not get back on full duty until I was in condition to do so. He asked me if I could come to Michigan. I told him that was an affirmative. I didn't have any place else to go. So I loaded up the family in the T-Bird convertible and the trailer, and we went to Michigan. Dr. Brister got me enrolled in the school, or tried to. They gave me all these entrance examinations. I was getting up in age, you know, and I didn't do very well at it. So the counselor called me up in the office to go through his regular routine on people that didn't do very well. And he said, "Well, Captain, we're not going to be able to accept you into Michigan State." I said, "Why not?" He said, "Well, you do not possess the ability to go through a college curriculum." Yes. I said, "Well, I've already got a year and a half at Iowa State. I've been through the Marine Corps boot camp in dozens of schools. I even went through warehousing officer school, and I went through the Marine Corps officers training school at Quantico, and passed all that with no problem. And besides, we have one outstanding thing, counselor, that I think you should be aware of. This is a land grant college, isn't it?"
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "Yeah." I said, "You're right, it is." I said, "And I'm a disabled veteran, aren't I?" He said, "That's right." I said, "By law, you can't keep me out of the school." Not many people know that. And I was accepted to the school. Dr. Brister put me on every athletic program he could possibly get me on, over and above the necessity of the necessary courses I had to take. But I took gymnastics, I took badminton, I took swimming, I took the science and practice of practice and science of the art of football. All the football players were in that class because they all got an A out of that class and so could remain eligible to play. I got an A to them. And then I took ballet and modern dance and judo. And I became the assistant judo coach at Michigan State. And for 3.5 years, I took every jock class that they had available. During that time, by the end of 6 to 8 months, I took an examination for law enforcement, passed it, went on the city police department down by Flint.
That's Durand, right?
Durand. Stayed there for approximately 6 months. Directed a narcotics raid, which they'd never had before. But there was a lot of narcotics traffic in that area. And I put together a narcotics raid under the direction of the county sheriff's department. Set it up so we had several controlled buys, house of ill repute was. And we even took a school bus, commandeered it from the school system, and took it over to that house late at night, surrounded the building, and pulled their very first narcotics raid. Very successful. We got a lot of crap out of there, made a lot